My name is Sara Stadtmiller. I'm a photographer. I've been one my whole life. I took a class when I was 15 in high school, a media graphics class that was also photography was part of it. And it just clicked. I was always really interested in art, and but finding the right medium proved a little difficult. But yeah, photography just felt right. There's a nice balance of like left and right brain for me. I'm into figuring out some, you know, chemistry and f-stops, and I like the math part of it too. I work as a professional photographer. I'm in my studio in Asbury Park now. But I also have a dark room at home and do a lot of personal work. And I'm a mom and a wife and a business owner. So trying to juggle it all, but it seems to, you know, the passion or the drive to the need to make new work doesn't go away. So I'm still doing it.
My name is Anthony Mangieri. I'm from New Jersey. I've been making pizza since I'm 15. I opened doing a pizza, the first one in Point Pleasant Beach, New Jersey in 1996, near the beach, and did that for about 8 years. And my family is Italian American. I kind of fell in love with making pizza and just food in general at a very young age. I wanted to open a pizzeria when I was really young, but I didn't have the money. So I ended up opening a bread bakery in Red Bank, New Jersey, because it was cheaper, because I didn't need to put like tables and like have a dining room. So me and my dad just built a counter and put an oven in, did that. And then finally opened up the pizzeria in Point in 1996. Up until about, I guess, 2 years ago, I made every single dough ball and every pizza since we started in 96. So in the last like 2 years or so, I've been transitioning into like building a team of like young guys that are passionate. And it's been kind of an awesome experience and growth for me, and also learning how to let go a little bit and start to use my ideas and thoughts for other things.
Yeah, business at the pizzeria, the first one.
Yeah. Yeah. Sarah,
you opened in 95?
96. Yeah. 96. You used to come in with Jim.
Yep.
That's and really I think, how I met you. Started to get to know you. You guys used to come in. Didn't you play chess?
Backgammon.
Backgammon. You guys would come on like a Sunday and sit at a table for like 3 hours. I'd have no other customers. And I just be like, whatever. I'd be like in the kitchen sitting on a stool, like reading a book. And you guys would be sitting at a table playing a game.
I think we found you through like body art.
Mike, tattoo shop.
Those guys.
I mean, I feel like that was such a beautiful time for all of us. It feels honestly, I don't know about for you, but for me, it feels like a really like another life.
Yeah.
It wasn't that long ago, really, but in a way it feels like it became a place for so many people to come that were, I always felt like doing such great stuff and whatever they were doing. So whether it was you doing your photography, or it was the tattoo guys, or it would be somebody in a band, it was just like, it seemed like it started to become a place that was where everyone that came in was like really amazing at what they were doing, but doing it strictly driven on passion, restaurateur, or anything like that. When I opened the place, I really just opened it because I loved Naples, and I loved the idea of trying to make that pizza the way I, in my head, it was supposed to be made. But then outside of that, I approached the place and set it up and ran it as if like you were just coming to my house and hanging out. I mean, at one point I had built like an altar in the corner, and I was collecting like all these crazy religious statues and stuff. And it looked pretty nuts because you'd walk across the parking lot and there was like windows near the oven, and you could see into this like wall that I had, like I had written this poem on the wall. And then I had like all this religious stuff and candles. And then I had like weird art hanging up, and not to be weird or to do anything unusual. I just felt like, well, I own the place. I had no employees. I did everything myself. You know, I didn't make really any money. I lived at home. I didn't even have a car at one point. So I just didn't care. I did it. My approach, especially in the beginning, was like, I'm just going to do this. And if it makes it and I can somehow survive and make a living out of this, I will. And if it falls apart, I'll go get a job like pumping gas. I don't really care. Like, people would bring their dishes into the kitchen when I was busy because I had nobody to do. I would be making pizza and there'd be a customer in the kitchen washing dishes. I'd have like four guys playing quarters in the kitchen floor smoking cigarettes. I mean, it was like a total free-for-all. There were no real rules. The only rules were don't ask me to make pizzas in a way that I didn't want to make them. That was going to be a potential physical situation. But besides that, there were no rules. Now I run it like a corporate scumbag. Nick Morgenstern, you know, I don't know if you guys know who he is. And again, he's also somebody who's very just connected to the arts and music and, you know, that world on his own. He's an extremely, extremely talented chef and ice cream maker. He used to work at Gramercy Tavern. I mean, he's owned a bunch of different restaurants and been partners and things in New York. And then he opened up Morgenstern's Finest. And the original location was on Rivington in the Lower East Side. And it blew people away. I became a fast fan. Him and I got introduced by a fellow named Brian Koppelman. He is a movie director and a TV guy. And he was friends with Nick and he was friends with me. And he was like, you guys got to meet. I think you two are going to like just become like best friends. And so we ended up meeting and like literally the next day we're like, hey, you want to meet up and go for a run? And that was it. We just started. Now it was a couple of years ago. And we just, you know, we both align on a lot of stuff. He's an extremely hard worker, a real grinder like me. A lot of restaurant guys, especially in the bigger cities, like, you know, they own a ton of restaurants, but they actually don't even know how to cook, or they're like, they never do, or they're not really there, or they're whatever. Nick is in the same, you know, skin of me, which is like, you know, he's there grinding it. Even all through COVID, he was still there, like trying to find a way to make it. Same with me. So we have a lot in common on our work ethic. So we had done, I'll make Same, it quick, we had something done. Together. So we decided to do a pop-up at Una in the Lower East Side. So he came in and took over the small plate area. We made it into a sundae bar. And we created three ice cream sundaes together, inspired by my heritage of Italian-American. As my grandfather also was an ice cream maker and owned a candy store. And he was a big influence in me. And then that was like a year and a half ago or more. And we kept thinking like, you know, we should do more. And then I like was like, why don't we make pints with this thing, you know, or do something with it. So I got the idea to reach out to some friends of mine who are artists that I am inspired by and that I, you know, really respect. And I wanted to have them create like a label with complete free reign. I gave them no direction or anything. All I said was, what flavor would you want to pick? So Nick and I developed the flavors first. We developed four flavors and then we kind of were like, okay, here's the four flavors. And, you know, we kind of let them pick what they wanted. Artist in Japan named Yusuke that I'm a friend of mine, Mike Evans, made a video of them. And they're friends with Tommy Guerrero. So there was this whole circle of things. And then Yusuke is very in like surf and skate culture in Japan and also in California. And so he was my first real thought. I was like, I would love to reach out to him. And this fella Zio that I used to mountain bike with in California, who is also another incredible, incredible artist. Based out of Mill Valley, young and just so talented. I mean, these guys are like killing it. And once it became for real, then I quickly was like, well, I want to ask Sarah because I want to do a photo one. And to me, there was nobody else to ask. So she was my first choice. I reached out. She told me to screw myself. I had a beggar.
Anthony was just saying like, oh, I just love your black and whites. And just kind of like, that was it. And, yeah. I went home and, you know, started thinking about it and really wanted to do this justice as well as like, I didn't want to just, because he was saying, you know, I've known Anthony for a long time. He's known my work for a long time. He was like referencing work that was, you know, some photos that have been around for a few years. I didn't want to just like go through the archives either. So, somehow that this had, the water pictures had clicked. So there's like a main photo on the big wrap, but then there's a bunch of other smaller photos that go around the lid. And I guess, you know, I've been working long enough where I don't even have to call them a series anymore. It's just like this ongoing interest and water, like people in water is I mean, it's always been very interesting to me and something I try to capture, like the energy of it. There's like a little bit of like, if you know, like Philippe Halsman, the jump photos that he did in like the 50s and 60s and beyond. There was like that element to it too. There's no real hiding or posing in some of, you know, that you're just like splashing around and you just can't help but express yourself genuinely, which is something I really strive for in portraits and, you know, in general in my artwork. So luckily that clicked. And then I started just, I mean, it might've been going a little into the archives because we were doing this in the middle of winter. So it wasn't like I could start shooting totally new material for it, but it was all recent work and stuff I hadn't put together yet in any sort of, you know, something that made sense to me. So it was like a nice way to connect the dots for me too. And also I really like how the wrap looks like a contact sheet or a film strip, you know, kind of further emphasizing the photography of it. And yeah, I'm really happy with it. And I, you know, it was hard to envision the final product. I've never put any of my work on an ice cream. I've never designed an ice cream wrap before. So it was hard for me to envision, but I couldn't be prouder. As Anthony was referencing before, we do have a lot of artist friends and makers. And that's always been really interesting to me to like photograph them and in their environments. And these like large format portraits, that's like with a 4x5 camera, with, like the bellows and you put your, you know, the hood under. And it, you know, I don't really have like a final vision until I got there, but I always just pictured like that oven is, you know, so beautiful and there was so much love and hard work went into it. But then also like just that with the sign outside, you know, just the light in front of that, like, you know, without getting the feel of the expansive view of the whole street, I still feel like there's like, that just looks like New York City to me, and that portrait outside. So I don't know. I think we had done a handful of those, but those were two of my faves. There was another one too, like with the gate pulled down in front that I liked.
Yeah.
Yeah, I know. Time flies.
Yeah, it really does. I feel so grateful though, you know?
Yeah, me too.
So many of us are so lucky, like to do what we love and keep being inspired too.